Hello and welcome to the Hard Sell, where the stick in the swill bucket rattles back. And thrill to another Not Brand X episode. This will be an unusual one, as it's mostly going to be about posters and magazine ads rather than filmed ones. And so right at the outset here, I'd like to give a shout out to Dave Dye, leading advertising creative for several decades, long enough to have become a historian of his own industry. Most of what I'm about to tell you is basically paraphrased, if not outright plagiarised, from his Stuff in the Loft blog, and almost all the images you're about to see also come from there. Basically, he's like a rich man's me. Do visit his site. So, what's the subject of the episode? Well, frankly, I don't know how the hell he managed to miss it, but it's Benson and Hedges cigarettes. I tackled tobacco a while back, even though I don't like it very much, on the flimsy basis that it's basically poison and it's good for nothing whatsoever except to severely harm and eventually kill its users. But because we didn't prove that until relatively recently, it's also a billion-dollar industry that we collectively like to pretend is no different from Coca-Cola or Pepsi. Partly out of fear that if it ever disappeared, the economy would collapse like a Jenga tower. Yeah, petty objections like that, but I did the episode anyway because tobacco advertising, particularly in the UK, is among the most fascinating in the industry's history, in part because of the fact that the damn stuff kills you, and the restrictions placed upon its promotion in consequence. But first, let's go back to before those restrictions came in, at the turn of the 50s into the 60s, a time when tobacco advertising was legal, unrestricted, and generally came in two flavours. Man adventures, in which lantern-jawed authority figures like naval captains, cowboys, even doctors, smoke manly cigarettes like they're made of testosterone rather than nicotine. Or, alternatively, proto-swinging 60s vignettes starring hip young kids on the go sharing ashtray-flavoured kisses and slim menthols. The most famous attempt at making an exception backfired so spectacularly it destroyed its own brand. But when brand new agency Collett Dickinson Pierce landed the Benson and Hedges print contract in 1962, they were undeterred by the fate of Strand. They had to stand out in some way. Benson and Hedges were and are a king-sized cigarette, nearly 3.5 inches long. That's their unique selling point, and also their disadvantage, because it means they cost more. CDP's task was to make it seem like value for money in some way, by associating Benson and Hedges with high-class, sophisticated, blue-chip living. They were aided in this by the already extant packet design. A shiny gold brick with faux-engraved lettering in prancy ligatured font. From this, CDP extrapolated B&H's identity. Gold. Gold. Gold!
Gold!
Pure gold. They're expensive because they're big, and big because they're classy. The transmission of this message required some of the earliest uses of minimalism in advertising, which eventually became a staple, even a trademark, for this brand in particular. Minimalism, of course, was becoming a hot artistic trend at the time, first in an ironic pop art idiom from the likes of Warhol, Lichtenstein and Richard Hamilton, and shortly after it went mainstream, reappropriated by the man in all face value sincerity. Because that's what happened. See also genericised punk being used to sell bacon. Anyway, they clearly had some of the best photographers in the game, because these adverts look gorgeous. Not only that, but they look the precise sort of gorgeous B&H needed them to look to get over the message. That their cigarettes were as classy and sophisticated as everyone and everything in Martha's Vineyard all at once. In fact, the luxurious gloss of the imagery did a better job of that than the copy. Which, mind, the gold metaphor until the vein was dead, and kept going until the land itself crashed on top of them. Every gold-related idiom or play on words was used, most of them at least twice, plus a few I'm fairly sure they just made up. Gold rush, gold reserves, golden rules, silence is golden, gold doubloons. This mind-melting cricket pun right here. Streets paved with gold. Golden fields of wheat. Golden moments. Golden gold in the gold gold. 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 Sorry. You may notice how the copy becomes gradually more oblique. Not, like, a lot or anything, but they start out with the question being answered by the slogan, Pure Gold from Benson and Hedges. And after a while, that degrades to just pure gold, before the answer decays away altogether and we end up with just the question. The campaign now having become so successful that the viewer subliminally provides the slogan themselves upon seeing the pack shot. And that's a real mark of success. Proof that CDP had successfully made the golden box into an icon. And that was going to come in handy. Because what you may also have noticed is that a couple of years into the campaign, the first restrictions on tobacco advertising come in. Every packet carried a government health warning, and every advert carried a strapline reminding you of that. Those restrictions tightened as time went on. By the 70s, that strapline had to include the warning itself. Soon, you can show people smoking the bloody things. Not that CDP's Benson and Hedges adverts ever had, fortunately for them. Many rival brands found themselves turning to the kind of arty minimalism CDP had pioneered. Having broken the template back in the early 60s, now what they'd used to replace it was the template. And on top of that, sales were starting to slip. By 1977, you could neither show cigarettes being smoked, nor discuss the idea of smoking them, nor describe them in detail, use the product's name, or indeed say anything in your copy whatsoever that might actually promote the product. Although you did have to include an estimated tar level and a message pointing out that the damn thing will kill you. With rules like that, the obvious, almost only thing to do was to abandon outright representationalism in favour of abstraction. Fortunately, they'd successfully made the gold box iconic enough to subliminally yell the product's name without any copy required. This being the case, CDP launched a new aesthetic, which grew out of the old one in as much as it placed the B&H box in interesting places, but with the requirement that those places make sense, carefully removed. The first set was snapped by legendary swinging London lensman Brian Duffy, Carnaby Street running mate of Bailey and Donovan, and one of David Bowie's photographers of choice. It was important that they picked Duffy to shoot the first few, because while it was far too expensive to hire him for more than 5 or 6 adverts, it then set the bar really bloody high for the future of the campaign. As you can see, you can draw a straight line, inspiration-wise, from the previous pure gold approach to this more abstracted, wordless version. But now, they weren't tied down by having to make some sort of gold pun, or indeed, any actual sense at all. Bear in mind that this is the 70s, and all of these had to be shot for real, with actual objects. The birdcage one in particular was a bit of a headache. The set was incredibly simple, foam roof, 2 green walls, door, birdcage, but it had to be lit just so that the cage's real shadow was cast somewhere the camera couldn't see so much as a hint of it, while the back projection of a caged canary in silhouette was positioned correctly to the picocentimetre to stand in for it. All the effort was worth it. With this campaign, Benson and Hedges cemented its place as Britain's favourite cigarette, and placed some of the most amazing, mind-bending imagery ever to loom over the British motorway system. One of the most famous is the Pyramids poster from Year 2, to the extent that it's practically an icon of advertising in itself. And once again, I remind you that this was shot for real, on location in Egypt. It was apparently a bloody nightmare, so they had to wait an entire week for the air to clear of smoke from nearby factories. Or take this one, actually shot in the national headquarters of the Liberal Party, supposedly in exchange for that lovely gold-fitted carpet. Or this one, where René Magritte meets Jack Vetriano. Or this one, which actively requires you to stare at the damn thing to find the point. Like a Where's Wally that doesn't tell you in advance who Wally is. The campaign became so ubiquitous, it was even bowdlerised by the Health Education Council in an anti-smoking ad. Although not the 9 o'clock news actually did it better. By the end of the decade, both B&H and CDP were musing about what this kind of thing would look like in video. Benson and Hedges hadn't advertised much in video for fairly obvious reasons. Advertising cigarettes on television was outlawed. And while cinema ads were still allowed, they were an expensive luxury that a brand like B&H didn't really need to worry about more than a couple of times a decade. Thank you. One of those times was coming up, however, and the opportunity to make what amounted to a motion picture adaptation of this sort of thing was too tempting. Of course, we saw this in the previous tobacco-related episode. Directed by Hugh Hudson, soundtracked by Godley and Cream, and notable for ostensibly being the story of how one of these posters gets made, underlining how important and central the posters, and by extension the power of the image itself, was to the campaign. Eventually, even some of the posters themselves started to circle the same metatextual plug hole. Incidentally, note the name of the film showing at the cinema in this one. Of course, a couple of years later, there was the unsettling 2001-influenced follow-up. Also made by Hugh Hudson, which might very well have darker things to say about tobacco and its promotion. Or it might just be going out of its way to be creepy as all fuck. The difference is somewhat moot. The Surrealist campaign went on throughout the 80s before the brand finally ran out of steam in the 90s, and the advertising increasingly lost its bearings. Although by then it increasingly didn't matter, as the noose continued to gradually tighten around cigarette marketing. Sports sponsorship was outlawed, warning messages became bigger and starker. Finally, all tobacco advertising was banned outright. And it didn't stop there. By now, even the iconic gold box itself is outlawed in this country, with all cigarettes of any brand now coming in uniform packets in deliberately drab and depressing matte olive green, studded with gruesome medical images, and with the brand names listed in apologetic white Helvetica several points smaller than the health warnings. No promotion of any sort is allowed. And I, for one, am fine with that. But there's a part of me that misses that brief period in the 70s and 80s when, legally prevented from laying out a direct message, tobacco advertisers were forced to turn to abstraction and representational symbolism. Little works of Magritte or Breton or Escher right there in the pages of the Radio Times. That's the paradox of these adverts. They're memorable thanks to the restrictions placed on them. Most adverts bellow. That's their job. Especially these days, in our ludicrously accelerated modern age, even television adverts scream in giant type in an attempt to embed the information in your head even while you fast forward past them. Gargantuan posters created to loom over motorways have always done much the same thing for much the same reason, except and until CDP and their Benson and Hedges spots. They force you to stop, to lean in, to really look, to actually engage with the damn thing, that you can't help but take in the message because you spent 5 bloody minutes just trying to dig out the bastard. Admittedly, that's not necessarily ideal for driving down the motorway, but that just adds an element of challenge. Besides, if you can't keep your eyes on the road, it's neither CDP's fault nor Benson and Hedges. They'd much rather you died by degrees over the course of a decade or two from cancer or pulmonary obstruction or emphysema or anything really, as long as you pay them for it. Hey, if the product didn't kill you, the adverts wouldn't have been so damn good. Creative for several decades, long enough to become a historian of his own industry. Yes, I know, I've got a fucking dentist on Friday. Hey, you lovely people, thank you for watching. Do you want to see these things a week before anyone else? Do you want access to even more video essays, random musings, and absurdist close-down based humour? Do you want to read and help shape my new book about the history of the British Broadcasting Corporation? Do you want me to continue to have food and shelter? Well, consider that one a bonus. Support me on Patreon now. Only good can come of it. I promise.